A lot of things in the market are very different. So what we'll have our editor-in-chief, Xin Guo, who is Chinese, but he speaks very good, perfect English, and he will present his point of view on the Chinese market. And then we will have later Jan Fridrich, who is for the Czech Aircraft Association, very much traveling between Czech Republic and China. And the Czech Republic achieved several achievements. One of it is a bilateral agreement with China, and this is very interesting for all of you who has business in Europe, want to have business in China, and there have perhaps a connection how it can be made possible easier. So I present, I hand over to Xin Guo, our editor-in-chief of Flying China magazine.
Thank you, Willy. Good morning, everyone. My name is Xin Guo. I'm the editor of Flying China magazine. I'm a professional flying pages. So I just do this very quick since we don't have much time this morning. I just skip the intro parts because I can see some of you were here from last year and the year before. So the subject of my presentation today is China's ambitious general aviation development plan for 2016 to 2020. Why till 2020? Because now that's the deadline for China's 13th five-year national development plan. That's like the big economic development plan for China. Unfortunately, China still has this 500-year, national development plan for the whole country from the old days. But this is the plan on top of everything, and this is a very, very important factor. And anyone doing business or having a vision for China should not overlook this national plan. And now the good thing for general aviation is that now general aviation industry is now officially part of China's this 13th five-year national development plan. So that's a very good news. That means that now there's going to be a heavy promotion and a push directly from the central government, from the very top. And that has been proven in 2016 that there were 23 generating directive policies issued by the different ministries and the government agencies of the Chinese central government. That was unprecedented for the first time in China's history. So there were this many directive policies issued from certain governments, and the most important one, is the one released in May last year by the State Department. By the way, the State Department is China's cabinet, called the Directive to Promote the Development of General Aviation Industry for the 13th Five-Year Plan. So these policies set a tone for China's general aviation development by the end of this decade. And this was the first ever directive issued by State Department. So that shows how strongly the central government is now promoting general aviation. So here is a big picture of China's five-year development plan for general aviation. You can see the comparison. Then now we would expect a huge increase for the next 4 years, actually, since we were already in 2017. Now, in 2016, we only have about 70 general aviation dedicated airports, plus about another 200 landing strips. And that is expected to increase to 500. And now we have less than approximately about 1,500 generation aircraft, and plus about another 1,000 unregistered airplanes. That's expected to increase to 5,000 in 4 years. And the fly hours, of course, from less than 1 million to 2 million fly hours. And the total market size, the government expects to increase 1 trillion RMB there, so that's about 138 billion euro. So by the way, now China might be the only major market in the whole world that's general aviation airplane fleet, the number of airplanes and the number of pilots are both increasing. And we've recently reports that some European countries like Germany, France, the airplane fleet and the pilots numbers all decrease. So China now is the only major market that is increasing. Now we have this. And now we have this ambitious plan for the next 4 years. So, okay. So coming up with this grand plan for the next 4 years, coming up with a bunch of supporting policies. What's the concerns about everyone here and at AERO is the developing plan for sports aviation that was issued by about 7 ministries. That was also unprecedented. So it's not issued not only by CAC, not by the Sports Aviation Alliance, but also by several other government agencies. It's called the Development Plan for Sports Aviation in China for the next 4 years. So that's also a comparison of the situation right now, the sports aviation in China right now, and the goal in China. So that you can easily see that's also a very amphibious and very concrete, detailed plan. This, I would say, also the first time in China's history. It's normally, all the policies from the Chinese government normally would be very, general, not this detailed, but this is a very detailed plan. I'm so sorry for this. Since perhaps we can work some aviation technology business. So, the central government also wants to set 41 demonstrative model generation projects, including 15 recreational flight sites and 16 sightseeing flight bays. So, I would say now there's no better time. Because Flying China, our magazine, has been publishing for the past 5 years, and we've seen the up and downs of China's generation, but I would say now it's no better time now to consider the Chinese market. And what's that mean for the European generation industry and for all the participants here today? I would say there are 3 big opportunities. The first is training aircraft demand. Now you can see all these numbers, and of course, Yan Fridrich, he would have a much more detailed numbers for all this information. But the general idea is that China's aviation market is developing so fast, and with the central government's very unprecedented strong support, there will be an unprecedented demand for flying aircraft and flight schools and the associated equipment. As well as for the electric aircraft, because the directive issued by CAAC particularly mentioned to promote new energy aircraft development. That was also the first time in any policy issued by the central government agency. And the electric aircraft is no longer a new concept in China. There are already several flight projects in China, RX-1E, that is the first type certified electric LSA in the whole world. And the airplane was here 2 years ago, and the team was here also this year. And we have Uni and Ehan, that's the multi-rotor simulator with the volocopter idea, and upside. So the electric aircraft opportunity is there, especially for flight schools, because flight school, flight training, flight schools are probably the biggest opportunities in China, I would say. And the EVE aircraft is perfect suitable for this kind of local flights, because we have to admit that it's still not very easy to fly cross-country in the long range in China. So but for local flights and training, electric aircraft is perfect. And of course, the equity investment opportunity from Chinese investors, because now the Chinese government really wants to promote innovation and high tech, and especially now with this 5-year plan for generation, the Chinese investors, both from the state side and from private sectors, are quite interested in general aviation projects, especially in Europe. By the way, now China is Germany's largest trade partners number one trade partners of Germany now is China, and Germany is, I believe, the third or the fourth largest trade partners of China, which means now there's the very strong trade relationship between Germany and China. So that just bundle Germany and China stronger than ever, and this would bring many more opportunities both for trade and for investment. So I think that's my quick presentation, and I'll be here, and I'll be here until the end of the show, and I'll be very happy to answer any questions you might have. Now I just hand over this opportunity to Ian. Thank you very much.
So I will try to be quick as well, because yes, the time is limited. So I will go quickly. My presentation is basically an update of the presentation which I had last year. It's based on a webinar which I did for EU SME in China over the internet. And it's based on my experience with general aviation in China, based on the fact that I am the main negotiator for the Czech aviation in China. And because Light Aircraft Association has a delegated power for execution of the rights for light aviation in Czech Republic, I am seen as a government, and this is the big difference. That's why we were able to achieve some of the things which for countries which don't have that government support, or the companies which are not able to get the government support, are unthinkable in China. And we also have one big advantage against the most of the West people, that we come from East and we know we are closer in our minds in the system which we used to have 30 years ago, so we can understand certain things which are difficult to understand for people from the free economy. So this is my biography, that's not important, and this is what I will try to say. This is about the Light Aircraft Association of the Czech Republic, and I'm just showing this in Chinese, because that's one important aspect of doing business in China. You must be able to have all your presentations and speeches in Chinese. That's why Willy is quite successful in China with flying pages, because he has a Shin and they put it to Chinese. English is, you think English is a worldwide language? Yes, it is, but not so much in China. The other thing is, you need to understand what is general aviation in China. You saw from the previous presentation that the Chinese government is talking a lot of about general aviation, but if you look to that 13-year plan, actually about the sports aviation, there is only about four lines. So in China, general aviation practically means something different that we are used to here, and you can see these red things which makes a big difference, because ICAO definition here is saying that the general aviation is not involving commercial air transportation or aerial work in China, that all is included. So mainly when high-level Chinese officials are talking about general aviation, they are talking about aviation which is related to transport of the people. So us coming from the lower end, sometimes we have a problem to find a common understanding what is possible. This is also a very important thing, is it's necessary to understand who is ruling China, Chinese aviation, and that's quite difficult. You can see that this is the organization chart of CAC. CAC stands for Civil Aviation Administration of China, and that's like the EASA thing. And you can see that they have seven regional offices which actually do the practical works on field, and that came with some problems with standardization and so on, even for the same plane being sold to the different regions of China. Okay. This is the location of these CAC offices across the China, so you can see how it's spread. The Beijing is here. Another big center is of the Chinese aviation industry in Shenyang and some other parts of China. This is just to see what is, if you put the numbers into some context. These are the gamma numbers, which basically says that in the world there is about 330,000 planes and type certificated planes, and about 700,000 pilots. So this is also interesting from the European perspective, that we are talking a lot about commercial airlines, but there is much more general aviation planes in the world. And this is the situation in the Czech Republic. I'm showing this just to make some simple calculation of the potential of the Chinese market concerning the planes. You can see that in Czech Republic, the Light Aircraft Association, which I represent, has actually three times more aircraft in the register than the Czech CAA. But if we go to China, then as we already said, general aviation in China is still at the beginning phase, so that the potential is quite big. The problem is that nobody knows when that potential you can realize or you can use that potential. To get any statistical data is extremely difficult, partly because most of them are in Chinese language, and also that the Chinese register is not public, or so you need to have a good connection. In 2014, I was lucky, and the CAAC showed me their book, and I was allowed to make notes. I was not allowed to take a picture. So this is what I remember. It was in 2014. Unfortunately, when I compare this year, and these are the numbers that Shin was using this for, 1472, these are public numbers, and they differ. The other problem is, they said in 2016 there was important 364 aircraft, 81 types. This doesn't match if you do the simple math here. So you should basically use a common sense and don't overestimate the numbers. But even if we take any of these numbers are much lower than the numbers in Czech Republic. And if you compare the numbers of the inhabitants and airports and everything, the Czech Republic has the size of one of the big Chinese cities, and there is 10 million city in China, I think you have a couple tens of them, maybe hundreds, So the other thing is interesting thing is this is the number from 2016. They somewhere published the top 10 imported aircraft, top 10 increases in the aircraft numbers in China. You can see here that basically, I would say two-thirds of them are helicopters. Yeah? So basically helicopters and autogyros, from several reasons, are more sexy in China than the fixed wing aircraft. And then other things is they are crazy about amphibians. That is related that in some places there is a lot of water and so on. But it's interesting numbers. But again, these numbers for a country which has 2.5 billion people or 1.3. If we put just the aircraft, these are the numbers from 2014. This annual report you can find on the internet. I have a link on the back, so you can have a look afterwards. But again, this is very little, very low numbers, private numbers again. And on one of the presentations last year in Xi'an, they said that they have more than 2,000 illegal planes. Say, how you can in such a strict society have 2,000 illegal planes? And they say, there's about 600 balloons flying without anything and others. And basically, if your friend is the boss of the local military airfield, you can do what you want. You don't need to type certification and etc. But you cannot make a business on that. That's the problem. Sorry for the technical problems.
That's a mix of European and Chinese technique.
So these are the if you look to the segment of the pilot licenses, there is 50,000 valid pilot licenses, but 3,100 of them are PPL licenses, only 708 pilot licenses, four pilot licenses. And you see the vast majority is airlines. Everybody wants to become airline transport pilot, so they do all of that. They have this, what is interesting, they have a rapid increase of these UAVs pilot certificates. If I show you the number from last year, it was like 2,000. Now it's 10,000. So this is the unmanned vehicles are I would say, on a higher stage than it's anywhere in the world. That's my personal opinion. And they train the people inside China and outside China. These are the examples of the right hand is the PPL license, the left hand is the sport license, which is issued by ASFC, stands for Association Aviation Sports Flying China, I think. That's, so these are the airports. So see, there is very few airports, and in the certain parts, it's really difficult. And the another problem is, in their plan, you saw that they want to have 500 airports in 2020-something. But those airports are not like the ultralight airports also. Their minimum airport is 1,200 meters, 30 meters wide concrete. Boeing 737 should be able to land that. That is, you know, and that's the part of the problem, that we talk about the different things. Next one. This is the other problem is the private ownership in China of the planes is very difficult. In practical, it's almost impossible. You must own it through the or operate it through so-called general aviation company, which these general aviation companies are different types. But for the private, is this CCR 91, which is the A-type company. You can see there is only 152 of them in China. So. Also, the access to the lower airspace is still an issue. In the past, when you want to fly, it was necessary to put flight plan 1 month before. Now, they move it to 2 weeks, and in certain areas, 3 o'clock day before. So hopefully, we are advising them, make it like we used to have in Czechoslovakia in 1989 and before. In the morning, you call, they say, yes, okay, and then you can fly. But basically, this is the part of the problem which we don't know now here. You just sit to the plane and fly. Next one. Okay, this is just showing how it's increasing, but it's still not big enough. Next one. Okay, and then what is the potential? You see, everybody expects that it will go very fast. Yes, it could or not. I personally think we are still on the blue line, and maybe we are somewhere here, like... somewhere here, you know, we definitely not here. But maybe in 2 years we could be there, or maybe in a year, nobody knows. This is very difficult to predict. What are the major problems for European investors? Different culture, personal point. Don't expect that you will achieve anything over the email. First thing, you must set up WeChat, because the Chinese work from WeChat. The second, you must expect to travel to China very often. Now, part of the success of the Czech effort is that we have government funding, so all travel where I go there is somehow supported by the government, and through the embassy, each time I go to China, each time I go to certain levels of the CAC just to polish the handles. That's very important. Otherwise, really, you don't achieve anything. And another important thing which you must listen, I learned two things, you know. Normally, I'm quite organized person which have a tendency to plan what I do in quite detailed way. Forget about it. You must have a general idea and don't be stressed that things start, are not as you agreed, you know. And my personal experience is really, don't make detailed plans because everything will be different. But usually it finishes in a positive way. So you know, but you shouldn't be stressed by the fact this is a big difference. Language barrier, I already said, Chinese. And another very important thing, you must have reliable Chinese partners. Without them, you cannot achieve nothing. That's a number one, and it's difficult to find it, especially for our lower end of the aviation, because here when somebody wants to come to our manufacturers, he usually knows the product and he flies. They don't know, you know, these people unfortunately don't have the historical experience with flying. What is the problem also for the certifying world here is this absence of bilateral aviation safety agreement, so-called BASA, between EASA and Civil Aviation Administration of China. Basically, if your company from history, for example, like Airbus, does not have this working arrangement, you will not be able to certify anything in China. Because they will say, sorry, press your politicians, we need to sign a bus up. Because the problem is more on the European side that we don't want, or not me, but the politicians don't want
everybody
to sign.
Everybody wants to go to Europe.
Okay, that's a different story. But basically, if you are in a business with certified product under EASA, you have a major problem because until the BASA is signed, you will not be able to make your regular business. The legislation, the access to the lower space, you know, Chinese are talking about this at least 15 years. And they are still continuing talking because I think they forgot to talk to their army, which controls the airspace. So, and without the airspace, you can fly. As I already said, the market does not exist in the terms we know it here in Europe. So you should respect their special features. And as I already showed, the aviation structure in China is complicated and work is very slow. Sometimes, rarely. Sometimes it's fast, sometimes it's slow. I give you one example. Okay. Different expectation for GA, also visibility. This is one of the major, it's called Kafu, it's Guangkang. It's one of the major flight schools in China, which trains about 1,000 pilots every year. That day, the visibility was like this. This is for the VFR. The picture looks probably better than it looks before. There was 25 Cessna 172 on a circuit, and this was like a miracle. They were coming out of the fog, landing, disappearing in the fog, and then coming back. And what is important, another thing for general aviation, you see these kind of people here, all of them white, all these stripes, I respect that, but for lower end, when I see this, these are not the pilots for our ultralights or sport planes. That's why, because they want to be commercial air transport, and they are quite efficient to get many people there. But the problem that the bottom end is missing. Yeah, and I think this is the probably the picture which I like most. This is the why I show you the Czech numbers. So if we accept the fact that I think that the Czech on the lower end are one of the market world leaders, then we have about 180 airports, which means this is one airport per 438 square kilometers. So if China would like to have the same sort of ratio, they would need about 22,000 airports. In their plan, there is 500.
Okay.
So, and the same thing if you do for the aircraft. We have 4,000 registered fixed wing aircraft. This is one plane for 2,600 inhabitants. So, if the Chinese would like to have it like in Czech, they need 500,000 of aircraft. So, this is showing the potential. But the reality is, now we are on fractions of these numbers. And it's questionable if they really ever will go so far, because that's a political decision. If the lower end flying, the GA, the sports flying, the most what you see here, if it is in their interest, and that's difficult to say. And here you have the Chinese regulation, so you can have a look, this is the rules. Some of them we have in English, and yeah, this is, what is important there is this APP project managed by, administrated by EASA. There is a person for that, Stefan Bartex. It's best to contact them. There is a website. You can see there will be next month or the end of this month, there will be first EASA CAC Safety Summit in Shanghai. But again, if you look to the agenda, it's more focused on the upper end, not for the lower end. So, this is what was the success of cooperation in Czech Republic. You can see that there is a lot of political effort, which is going in. The main thing is you need to go there. This is the administrator of CAC, Feng Zhengling. This is the most important person. For us, the second most important person is this vice administrator, Wang Qiqing, which is about my age. And those are really in their hierarchy, those are like ministers. And you normally, without, this is our minister and this is our prime minister, without them, you never ever have a chance to come close to them. You can confirm it. And these pictures are important for dealing with Chinese partners, because this picture for them makes you are a valuable person. I have one better, because I have a picture when I'm shaking hands with their prime minister. And when I show it on a meeting, they go, you know, yeah. For them, that's unbelievable that you can actually touch such a high person. We normally don't do this in Europe. This, for me, in Europe doesn't make any sense. But you don't forget, this in China makes sense. If you look to some of their presentations, you will see that first two pages, there are pictures like that. These are the opportunities for business. Almost any kind, and she said, electric aircraft, you know, the unmanned vehicles. I think the unmanned vehicles, I already said that they are more developed than us, because they do things which we cannot do through our regulations, because...
I mean, seriously.
Yeah, for example, I never saw, like when I came to China first time 4 years ago, I never saw spraying, crop spraying in agriculture by unmanned vehicle. That's, for me, I was quite, and it's quite quite normal there, and so on and so on. So these are the useful contacts. When you go to China, this EU SME Center is there for us. This is for the small and medium enterprises. They sit in Beijing, and they are quite friendly, I would say. Another very important thing is, before you go to China with your product, protect your intellectual property rights. Because their way of looking to that problem is different from ours. For example, yesterday I had an interesting discussion with one of my Chinese colleagues, and he said, oh yeah, we copy these things, because if we copy, this means that product is good. No? And that's completely different from our philosophy here. This is the contact for APP, Stefan Bartek in EASA. I very much recommend you contact your commercial department of your embassy, because they know the bits in at least in Beijing, and they can help you. They can go with you on the meeting, and this helps, because it opens the doors. And I think these are the things where you can get some information about China, and this is just, it could be I will tell you one story from this APP and then I finish. Yeah. I was a part of the initial phases to preparing that. We were meeting all the European major players like Airbus, Lufthansa, Rolls-Royce, Safran, Snecma, you know, you name them. Then we met all the relevant CAC departments. Then I realized that maybe except from Airbus, all big names are sitting in Beijing for many years, not making money, waiting for that big opportunity. Nobody knows when it comes. So be careful with that, because it can destroy your business. That's my personal advice. But the opportunity that China is nice, Chinese people are very friendly, but it's difficult to find out what they really think. So.
Thank you, Jan. Thank you, Xin. We try to do it as fast as possible. I know it's just bits and pieces which we can give you there, but it gives you a little bit look. We will stay here for questions, but we know for most of you the show is starting. Some of the problems which Jan mentioned, we try to address with our magazine, for example, for the social media, like Jan said, because here you do your promotion in on social media, in WhatsApp, Facebook, YouTube. These three channels are banned in China, so you can't look at them. So you have your films, your promotion in there, nobody will see it in China, except some people who have a hack. The Chinese companies do their promotion in the copycats of these channels, or sometimes the copycats are even more advanced than the originals, which is WeChat, Weibo, and others. So what we started last year, and it is a kind, we call it the social media bridge. So if you work together with us, you have something you want to promote in both sides, we make sure that it's in the right channels, in the right way, like in Chinese, in the Chinese channels, and published in the right way in this social media. And on the other hand, for example, here, we have our show guide, which we've done in German for several years with all the aircraft at the light end, and especially based on the electric aviation. We discovered, sure, there was a high demand, so we made an English version of it, which we handed out to the people, but now we have a lot of Chinese guests coming, and although the people you think they're doing international business, so they speak English, no, they don't. So we have a Chinese version of it as well, and we've done it that you can download it with a QR code, so if you didn't have a copy yet, or it's the wrong language, just come here, and it's also at our booth, you can scan it, so you have it on your agenda, on your cell phone. The other thing is, if you came late, because you know we changed place and everything, we could record this presentation and several other important presentations, and you can watch them at our Flying Pages channels and at the eFlight Expo channel. Having this said, I would say the second thing is, like Jan and Xin mentioned, the most important thing is finding a reliable partner and having a personal relationship. So we realized this over years, because first when we started the magazine, we said, we may do a magazine like we do here, and the rest will be done by others. It's not working like this. So last year we made the decision that we'll have the social media bridge. And on the other hand, we also do actively B2B, which is like Xin now moved from China here to Europe, so he's available. So if you want to do meetings, and we do B2B consultants as part, which normally you don't do at the magazine, but we see there is a need to do it, because there are not many people who have the know-how on the market on both sides. So if you have interest in any of this, just contact us. Now we're open for questions, and we're here at the until the end of the show. Just grab a business card and contact us later if you don't find the time at the show, which is very often the time. Okay, thank you for coming. I just forgot, we offered you a breakfast, and you came, and the breakfast wasn't here yet. It's also because all of the change now, we have some breakfast in the back, so grab some bites. And Jan has some more remarks.
Maybe just wonder, I forgot to mention it in my presentation, why this MTL 600 kilo an hour memory is here. As you maybe know, there is a change of the basic regulation underway, and we would like to get 600 kilo out of EASA so we can fly legally the ultralight with the realistic payload. This has also implication for China, because in China the definition of ultralight aircraft is to 560 kilogram and 380 kilo empty. And for example, all Czech microlights which receive, now we have two with the verified type certificate, could be only sold as a 472.5 kilogram with parachutes, because we cannot issue the certificate for 560 kilogram.
Empty will be for ultralight amphibian, 650?
No, same. 600.
This will be
600. Everything.
Okay.
Because doesn't matter what you install.
This is one of the intentions to have not all the different weights.
There is a presentation. Right, you see in that there is a presentation in 11 o'clock in a room of Austria on the opposite side.
We also have a calendar of all the important.
We also have a calendar of what we think the important. Talks on the light end of aviation in this summary, so either you grab a copy in German or you scan the code. There is a copy in German, but if you would like it in English, it's better if you scan it here with your cell phone. Okay, any questions?
Okay.
That's good. So if you have any personal question where you think it's just considering what you want to do, we stay up here at, in front, and we may change business card, and so we'll stay another few minutes here as long as you want.
I just have a question for the first presenter.
Yeah.
He just loaned some 138 million billion euros or something for the overall market. So how much do you estimate regarding the segment for the sport aviation? That's what the people probably is interested in here.
Well, perhaps I think good. First of all, the any of this development plan does not mention specifically, because that's how the new government does. They do not give a very specific number. However, I think the good rule of thumb is to use the current ratio to as a comparison. So now, let's say we have about 2,000 general aviation aircraft, among them about 700 are sports aviation. To the sports aviation aircraft. So if we use that as benchmark, then out of this 138 billion euro expected general aviation market by the end of 2020, then that could be huge. That could be easily several thousands of billion for the sports aviation. But I personally do not expect that big of increase for the next 3 or 4 years, because if that's materialized, even the whole world production rate can, production capacity could not match.
And that's again, there is one thing which Jan said, it's very much depending on how the airspace opening is going to take place. Because like, no airspace, no much business with aviation. There is some business with this 500 airfields which is going to be built. There are a lot of aero industrial parks in construction, and this is all included in there. Because like, when they say general aviation, it's everything which is not commercial airliners. So, if you build a business airfield with citations in some area, that's general aviation. So, this is most part of the business now. But, having this said, there are movements, like there are some regions where now there are private public partnerships, where the CAAC, together with a private company, starting to do air traffic control. So, still under the umbrella of military, but the goal is to have the lower airspace, which is the airspace we fly, which is up to 1,000 meters, that this will be step by step given to civil authorities. And I have seen Chinese companies in Oshkosh looking for partnerships from companies for getting this air traffic control. So when we talk about this investment, it's not just aircraft in GA like our aircraft, it is radar equipment, it is airfields building, it's all this included, and only a very little portion is right now in the aircraft, and it will be even perhaps increasing when the airspace opens, because otherwise they will be not flying. But there are also some good aspects, because like already 3 years ago, again last year, I was flying in an airfield which is private, without flight plan, which they get a permission one day before, and then you can fly all day at this airfield. So there are changes happening. There are people, you come to airfields, there are about 20, 30 existing aircraft. So there are changes happening, but it's happening slow. But if you look at some companies which have started with this business quite a while ago, they already have a reasonable business, about 50, 60 aircraft per year, which they sell into China. So it is worth looking at the market, but you have to look at the right way. Okay, so if there are no more questions, we would...
what I didn't understand is the push for sport aircraft in China. Will that come from like rich individuals, or is that a government policy, or where's like, what is the driving force there?
Sure, it depends what you for now define again, sport aviation. So
it's like the
two-seaters. Two-seat. So one thing, I think in the next 2 years, the main push will be flight training. Because flight training is something where the government agreed it must have happened. And if you look at the number of airliners, they have this, they ordered about 1,800 airliners until 2020. And for this, you need about more than 50,000 pilots additional. The rate there at the moment is 1,200 per year. It's easy to calculate, it's not enough. And that there, well, there is a strong government support for flight training, and I know in Czech Republic there are also some cooperation with Chinese. So the largest Czech school, they already start now forming Chinese pilots, I think, in Czech Republic.
Yes, but that's different from your question, because he was asking about the sport aviation.
Yeah, yeah,
the main problem, in Czech, yes, there is a flight school which was coming to China for 7 years, and then finally they make a deal with the Sichuan Airlines, and somehow the first 30 Chinese pilots will be trained, or they are already in Czech Republic and will be trained. So that's the business for the flight school, which is focused on commercial transport, from zero to something. What bothers me is the lower end, ultralight and LSA. That is a problem, because for them, that's not, you know, what they are missing at least two generations of pilots, of flying as a hobby. You know, I had an interesting discussion with one of the instructors, was like 25 years old, he had about 1,000 flown hours. I said, why you fly? He said, I fly for money. I don't fly for money, I fly for fun. And the problem is that they don't know, most of them don't know what is to fly for fun. So, you know, and that's really, so I'm a little bit skeptical when you ask who is pushing that, us. I think that pressure for lower end of aviation is coming from us, because we have the products, and we should persuade them that product is one thing, but the customers needs, you know, must be pilots. So if you don't generate the lower end pilots, you will not have a business. I have a nice, you know, this is what I'm showing in China. Sorry that I will destroy one of your, you see, you have a triangle. This is a classical aviation here in Europe. A lot of general aviation pilots, airliners, astronauts, or something. And China, it's the other way around. And I'm always saying this is not very stable. So you must make it a little bit more stable. Not like that immediately, but at least like a little bit.
Is for example, then sport or flying for fun, is that considered a good thing by the Chinese government? Or is that not?
The thing is, it's not in the view of the people, and that's where we try to get it there. This is, for example, why we have the magazine and give away the magazine for free. This is, you know, we're sending it to flying schools, to normal schools, and we have connections with private banks. So it's going to private banks, but the people who have the money see this and see perhaps the fun, see the fancy thing, and in the end get somehow into aviation. Some get in there, they will invest, and some people just go there and try to do, oh, it's fashion. And if it's fashion, then suddenly it's going to be huge. And this is where we are working on, and this is also where we, for example, need your support as manufacturers, because if you want the market growing, then you should support us. We do the magazine, we do the basic work, and as we give away the magazine for free, we need your advertising. That's very simple. But it's part of the game, and we do it in the social media, and I think like this is working. We report about flying schools, and there is a question there.
No, I just want to make a comment to the question before. You asked how is the flight look like, and as far as I read, the State Council wants to push this for all sport aviation activities below a range of, I think as far as I can tell, 200 kilometers, to increase the domestic consume, to also to get a better economic development of the locals. And I'm sure Sue can confirm this. It was written in the newspaper, so it's also pushed from the government.
But the government still has to kind of open up that airspace to make that possible.
I just a quick remark. The reason why I'm so open to you is we need to do our homework, which means we must make a promotion, regardless if I'm from Czech Republic or it's from Germany. That's why we cooperate on this level. The China market is so huge that it really doesn't make sense to separate You know, we always, even I speak for Czech, this is for good for you as well.
I just thought about a small company trying to promote flying for fun in China.
No, that's why you can work with us, because that's why we started.
You can work with us, that's why we started it, and we find channels. We have like cooperation with television channels. You have like companies like Continental, which is a huge state company, but they are inside because Continental was bought by the Chinese company AVIC, which is a huge aviation company, and they have their own channel. They have their television channel, they have other social media, and we try to persuade them to get them also in the light end sector, and as Continental is selling leisure aviation engines, they getting there. So there are opportunities, but you have to be aware that it's not like it is here. This is the thing I learned over 5 years. It's very different. Sometimes they speak the same language like you, they speak good English, but they don't understand you because it's another cultural background.
Yes. You mentioned that there is no bilateral agreement between China and EASA, but is there one with FAA?
Yes, at the moment there is one with the FAA, which is from a longer time in the past, and the problem is there, this bilateral agreement is not just on GA, it's a general bilateral agreement, it's on the Airbus side, on the big aircraft, and the Chinese side want that if it is there, for example, that the new Chinese airlines are recognized immediately, and sure, there is also concern on the European industry and on the European EASA, which is the safety side, that perhaps they don't believe that it's just there. So we have to have this challenge that we're with them in a big pot, and they won't give you the permit for your small aircraft because the big Airbus people are involved. So one of the solutions is when you're on the market with light sport aircraft and ultralight aircraft, that's what the agreement which the Czech achieved, is below the radar. If you go below the radar of EASA, you do an advanced ultralight, you have a certification for this ultralight in Czech Republic, there is a validation of the certification, and you may fly and may produce this aircraft. So if you want to start a business in China, perhaps it's wise to start this at the moment with something which is going over Czech Republic, because then you have an open door, only up to at the moment 450 kilograms, but that's why the 600 kilograms raising the whole limit which is below EASA is so important for us, because if this is raised, your window is a little bit more open, up to 600 kilograms. Okay, so perhaps you grab a bite and grab some of our magazines on the way out, and if you have any questions, we're still here, but I know you're here on the show to make business, so let's go.